Good evening, my dear friends. I am going to talk about a 40-year journey starting from 1984, when maybe I was your age, to now, and how I dreamt the impossible dream and how I converted that impossible dream into reality and in the process changed the course of medical history as it is known. I'm primarily a neurosurgeon with special interest in the field of regenerative medicine. I will start with the origin of my dream, which is again 1984. I was a medical student, intern at that time, and I came across a patient like this, a patient with a cervical spine injury. That means the spine was fractured, and because of that, he was paralyzed in both his upper limbs and lower limbs, something called quadriplegia. You can see this is the spine that is fractured. And this image, by the way, is generated by AI. But there was a real patient. The patient is paralyzed. He's lying on a bed, can't move his hand, can't move his leg. And so I asked the doctor, why can't we do something to help him? So he said, no, he's got a severe spinal cord injury. It's complete. Nothing can be done. Either this patient will die or he will remain paralyzed for the rest of his life. And when the doctor said that, the patient heard what he was saying. Imagine, you're a happy-go-lucky young person, you have an accident and you're paralyzed, and your doctor is saying you will die or remain paralyzed for the rest of your life. In that moment, my eyes met the eyes of the patient, and I saw the anguish of an alert mind in a body which will not respond. And then I asked the doctor again. I said, but why can't you do anything for him? So he said, because the central nervous system, once it is damaged, it doesn't regenerate, it doesn't repair. And in that moment, as my eyes met the eyes of that patient, I decided that my life will be about this, that I will work towards regenerating the central nervous system. By the way, 1984, we didn't have internet. We didn't have Google, mobile phones, or even personal computers. There was a life before the internet, people. Can you imagine that? We lived that life. And so when you wanted information, our source that time was the British Council Library. So I went there, spent days over there, tried to read up everything on the subject. And what all my colleagues and teachers, as well as all the published literature said, the central nervous system, once damaged, cannot be repaired or regenerated. Everybody was saying the same thing. But what I decided 40 years ago is that I will devote my entire life towards repairing and regenerating the central nervous system. A big decision to be made by a 23-year-old student. The first next step was to acquire qualifications. And from 1986 to 1992, I first did my MS in general surgery and then MCH in neurosurgery at the KM Hospital and St. GS Medical College. And then I had an option. As a qualified neurosurgeon, I could start practice like most of my colleagues and I could have an income in lakhs, or I could start working in a government hospital medical college, where my salary was 6,000 rupees at that time, 1992. But I chose to work as a faculty in the Lokmanya Tilak Municipal General Hospital because over here I could do research. I gave up an income of several lakhs and everybody thought I was crazy. What are you doing, you know, working in a municipal hospital? But here I knew I could do research. So I joined as faculty. When I joined faculty, I didn't have the tools. I didn't have the technology. How do you do laboratory work to regenerate the nervous system? So I realized I have to go overseas, but I didn't have money. So what I did was I went around. That's the list of all the trusts that I went to in Mumbai that gave loans, scholarships, educational loans. And I got this scholarship. And with this, I then went to the Karolinska Hospital, Stockholm, Sweden in 1995, where they had for the first time in the world done fetal cell transplants for Parkinson's. And I thought, this is something close to my heart. You know, if they are able to regenerate the nervous system there, I should go there. But by the time I reached there, they had actually stopped the work. But I did learn a lot of things at Karolinska. Karolinska, by the way, is the institute that gives the Nobel Prize in medicine. The Nobel Prize you've heard of is given by Karolinska. And then I went to the United States, to Denver, Colorado, the University of Colorado Health Sciences. And it was over here in 1998, that I learned how to do cell culture. I learned the laboratory technique of how to grow cells, how to regenerate cells. And then I came back and I started doing basic research at the medical college, but I had no space. So I requested one department to give me an unused room. I had no equipment. And I went everywhere to different departments. I took somebody's broken microscope, somebody's broken incubator, and people laughed at me. What is wrong with you? Why are you taking our broken equipment? I said, give it to me. I fixed it. I used rubber bands and threads and, you know, repaired things. But I got equipment and a place, but I had no money. So then I applied to the government of India for research grant. So my first application rejected. And that was a 400-page application. Can you imagine a 400-page application gets rejected? Then I applied again. Again, it got rejected. And then I applied again. And again, it got rejected. Three applications, each application, about 300 to 400 pages. But the fourth one got accepted. And I got 16 lakh rupees from the government to start my basic research. The important thing is, I did not give up. I didn't have place. I borrowed a place. I didn't have equipment. I used broken equipment and repaired it and fixed it. I didn't have money. I applied. And finally, I got 16 lakhs. And that's the laboratory, the basic fundamental laboratory where we did all our initial research. And we published these scientific papers from our experimental work. I had the qualification. I was a neurosurgeon. I had the tools and technologies from overseas, from the best institutes in the world. I had done 10 years of basic research. 10 years is a long time of basic research. Now I was ready for the real deal. Now was time to start helping patients. And from 2008 onwards, we started converting this dream into reality. We started doing work initially at the medical college itself, at the Lokmanya Tilak, but I realized the need for a separate center to do this work. So we rented a premise in Chembur, in an existing hospital, in the basement. You know, we actually rented half a basement and we started work, this work in half a rented basement. And then we did, on 17 December 2008, we did our first stem cell transplant at the new center. This, by the way, 17 December is also the day when the world's first flight took off by Wright brothers at Kitty Hawk in America. So just like 17 December 1903 was the day when the world's flight took off, on 17 December, our first cell transplant was done, which also, just like the first flight, it changed the course of aviation history. All our flights, all our space travel was born on this day. Likewise, I will show you how what happened on 17 December 2008 has forever changed the way medicine is practiced. In 2014, then we bought our own building and now we have an 11-floor building where we can do the work. And in 2019, we bought another building. So now we have two buildings that we function out of. So what exactly are stem cells? The word stem comes from the stem of a tree. And just like from the stem of a tree, you have branches, leaves, flowers, fruits, etc. There are some cells from which all the other cells of the body can arise. So the cell from which you can get a nerve cell, a blood cell, a brain or a muscle cell, that cell, the fundamental cell from which all tissues arise, these are known as stem cells. How do they work? First, they have the ability to multiply. So if you have a single stem cell, you can make several million stem cells from it. They convert into any type of cell. That's the most important thing. A stem cell can become a nerve cell, a heart cell, a blood cell. Anything you want, it can become. It improves the blood supply to it where it goes. And it also releases certain positive chemicals called growth factors. So because of these, they can repair, they can regenerate, and they can replace damaged tissue. So using this principle, we started using cellular therapy. You have to understand that prior to this, we had only two types of medical treatment. Either you had drugs like tablets, injections, etc., or you had surgery. You went, you cut, you stitched, and you put things together. This is not a drug. It is not a surgery. It is cellular repair. Just like if you know your finger gets cut and your body heals itself, that healing which happens, that's a biological healing. So this is the healing that stem cells do. You know, in 1980 or early 90, if I wanted to do a video recording, I needed a video camera. For still, I needed a still camera. I needed a computer to type. I needed a music player to play music, a calendar, a telephone, calculator, a TV screen, a torch, a compass, and a map. For all of these, when I was your age, I needed separate tools. At that time, who would have dreamt that one day, all of this will be in the palm of your hand? All of this that we couldn't even imagine that time. If somebody told us in the 80s and 90s that all this will come into your hand, it was unbelievable. But this has happened. The same thing is true of stem cells. Earlier, you required drugs for neurogenesis, to prevent cell death, for trophic factors, for myelination. These are medical terms. And now all of that is now done by a single cell that we refer to as a stem cell. We have, as part of fulfilling my dream, treated 14,000 patients from 103 different countries. People from all over the world are now coming to India, to Navi Mumbai, to take treatment. There was a time when people who were well-to-do used to go from India overseas. And here I'd like to tell you a story. Between Sweden and America, I went to England. And I remember when I was in England, I finished my training. And then the professor there told me, why do you want to go back? You know, stay over here. You'll be able to do much better work here. And I looked at the professor and I told him, Professor, I'm going back to my country to serve my people. But one day people from your country will come to my country for my treatment. And at that time, everybody laughed. But I made it true. I mean, we have not only people from England and America, but every week we have about 40 patients or so from different parts of the world, all coming to us for treatment. This is the largest number. There is no institute or hospital in the world that has treated 14,000 patients with cell or stem cell therapy. We also have published 109 scientific papers. We have published the largest number of papers in the world. There is no doctor, no hospital that has published so many papers. Now, why is this important? In the medical world, you have credibility only when your work is published in peer-reviewed medical journals. Why is it so? Because when your work is published in a journal, the journal's editor, the editorial board, and in three independent reviewers verify your data, its authenticity, its scientific content, its ethical content, and only then they publish it. So we don't have one or two. We have over 100 scientific papers, 16 of them in autism, 15 in cerebral palsy, 20 in muscular dystrophy, 9 in spinal cord injury, 11 in motor neuron disease, 6 in stroke, 4 in intellectual disability. And we also did a lot of work in COVID. We have published 8 chapters in medical textbooks. So medical textbooks are books that doctors and medical students read. And now, whenever anybody wants, all over the world, and these are all international books, they aren't Indian books. So when international editors are looking for who will write a chapter on stem cell therapy, they request us to write it. So we've written for all these books. There was a time when we learned and read from books written in the United States and England. And today, people from England and United States are reading our chapters and learning from them. That is the shift that has happened. We've also published 18 books. So we have a large number of books. And our books, by the way, we never charge for it. All our books are distributed without cost, whether it's hard copy or whether they are soft copies. I've always believed that knowledge is Saraswati, and that is something that, being a professor, not something you can charge for. So all our books are available without any cost. Now, our pioneering scientific publications in autism is something I'd like to focus on. What exactly is autism? So autism is a neurodevelopmental disorder. It typically appears in the first 3 years of life. Boys have it 4 times more than girls. The incidence is increasing a lot. So my conclusion is, first, dare to dream. Second, believe in yourself. These two are very fundamental. Third, make a roadmap to convert your dream into reality. I had a roadmap. Okay. Have a clear long-term goal and divide this into several short-term goals and work on one short-term goal at a time. This is very important. You need to have a long-term goal, split it up into short-term goals and keep working on one at a time. Be patient, persistent, and perseverant. You do not give up. Don't let the naysayer critics stop you from converting your dreams to reality. Work hard with your head, heart, and hands. This is very important. Your head, your heart, and your hands need to be aligned. When I was a kid, I used to watch Star Trek. And a lot of things in Star Trek, at that time, they used to use mobile phones, the flip phones. We thought that is science fiction, but that is so true today. So a lot of what was fiction yesterday is fact today. And I like to sing this song. This is my last slide, so I'm going to actually sing this. To dream the impossible dream, to fight the unfeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to love pure and chaste from afar, to try when your arms are too weary, to reach the unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far. to fight for the right without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know that if I'll only be true to this glorious quest, that my heart will be peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest, and the world will be better for this. That one man, scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable star. Thank you so much for your attention.